I'm going to ask Hazelmary Bull to come up and join me now. Hazelmary, a lot of people will know a bit about your story, the fact that you were sued for your policy of only giving double beds in your B&B to married couples, married opposite sex couples. But let's just get a little bit of the background. How long have you and your husband Peter been involved in the hospitality industry?
Well, we had 10 years at a guest house in Redruth, and we've now had a total of almost 29 years at the hotel. So we know, we picked up a bit on the way, definitely. So we know a thing or two about the industry.
And your married couples only policy, that actually hit the headlines quite some time ago, I think in the 90s. What was that about?
We have always felt like that ever since we've let rooms, because coincidentally we became Christians at the same time as we bought the guest house. And we moved into the hotel and implemented the same policy that we'd had at the guest house. Now, in 1996, in a roundabout way, our local paper picked up the story and did a feature on us. And we had a huge amount of support. A lot of talk radio stations rang up and interviewed us and so on.
And this was to do with turning away unmarried heterosexual couples.
It was exactly the same thing. It was to do with unmarried heterosexual couples. You see, we hold this policy because we're interested in marriage, not anything else. We were there to defend marriage, which we've seen for years was under threat. And it's got nothing to do with sexual orientation.
So your policy was pretty high profile. Was it public? You obviously, the case that you're involved with that arose when Mr. Hall and Mr. Pretty came to stay, was your policy public before they came to stay?
Well, it was through that local newspaper article and national talk radio program. So it was no secret. It was also the statement, as you've seen, was on our internet site. And on page one of our website, there's just the sign of the fish, which just quietly told folk that we were Christians. It's not a Christian hotel. That we've never felt that was our calling as such. It's a hotel run by Christians. So everyone's welcome as long as they understand and accept our double bed policy.
So what happened on the day that Mr. Pretty and Mr. Hall turned up?
Yeah, well, unfortunately, I got caught in a telephone call the night before. I wasn't well, and I took the call because there was nobody else near the phone. And I went through the usual procedure of booking someone in. As it happened, they took the last room that we had, which happened to be a double bedded room. So they filled us up with that booking, and I took the booking, and afterwards when I put the phone down I thought, oh my goodness, because over the years we've developed a script, and the script goes, you hear a man's voice, you say perfectly politely, because we're not out to cause offence, like you said, it happens, but we try to guard against it, and so perfectly politely you would say, is this for you and your wife? And oddly enough, folk would always answer honestly. So if they said, no, we've been together a week or we've been together 100 years, then we would politely say, well, we prefer to let double beds to married couples. You'll probably feel more comfortable somewhere else. And we never had any trouble at all with anybody until this booking. So when they came the next day, nobody was more surprised than us to find that it was two gentlemen and not a husband and wife, especially as I'd shared with my colleague, our chef, Bernie, the night before, that I'd done this thing, that I'd forgotten to ask about whether or not he was married. And he said, what name was it? And I said, Preddy. And he said, don't worry, and Mrs. Preddy rang up this afternoon and asked if we took dogs. So I said, oh yeah, there is a dog. And I went off to bed perfectly happy, thinking that a married couple were going to show up the next day, which, of course, that wasn't the case. And because that was the last room we had, we couldn't offer them two single rooms, which we would have done if we'd had them.
Did they get somewhere else to stay?
Yes, they did. They went to the police station, and the police station have recorded Pete's and my crime as a non-hate discrimination crime, isn't it? They then found them alternative accommodations. So they were tourist board agents for a while, and the police found them alternative accommodation in the town.
Now, when the Bristol County Court ruled mm-hmm. that you had discriminated against Mr. Preddy and Mr. Hall, ordered you to pay £3,500, one of the things the judge said, of course, was he realised he was forcing you to go against your religious convictions. Yeah. Then there was the appeal. Mm-hmm. That was very high profile. How mm-hmm. did it feel being in the midst of all that?
Well, I nerve-wracking, obviously. We'd already suffered. By then, our business was in big trouble because one of the hidden things that happens to folk like us, and I'm sure this is the sort of thing that nobody's ever thought through, the knock-on effect for us, and the worst one really, was that we were registered with the English Tourist Board, and they came to see us and said, had we any plans to drop our policy, which oddly enough, they knew all about. And the first year we were there, they employed a band of lawyers to find out how we could legally turn unmarried couples away. They held a meeting in London and they came back to us and said we would be within the law if we inserted the name private in our title. So up until 2008, when this happened, we were Chime of a private hotel. They then told us we would have to drop the word private. We couldn't count on their protection anymore. And that when our membership became due, not to renew it unless we changed our policy. And they told us they would require a written statement from us to say that we changed our policy. That's a government-run department, so obviously we were out of step with government policy.
How much of your business came
well,
through
then? Well, that meant that we couldn't advertise in the Cornwall, the Visit Cornwall magazine anymore, and that easily brought in between 60 and 70% of our business, because we kept track of where our business came from. So that was a huge blow. We weathered the storm for a time because we want to stay there. It's a job we were all trained for. I went to university for 3 years to learn the hospitality industry. Darling taxpayers funded my time while I was at the university because the quality, the thing has been put to us. Why don't we change careers? Well, why should we? It was what we were trained for. It's what we enjoy. You've only got my word for it, but we're actually good at it. And it just, that is not an argument. The same argument was put to Lillian Ledaley, I believe. And why should she? She was a registrar. She was trained for it. She enjoyed it. Why should she change her career? Because like you said, I'm taking it a long way now. But are Christians only going to be able to sweep the streets one day because everything else would be closed off to us?
So unfortunately, you lost your appeal, and then you went to the Supreme Court, and you were asking the Supreme Court for reasonable accommodation.
Yes.
And they said
yes.
No.
Yes.
One of the five Supreme Court judges involved in your case was Baroness Hale. And after your case, she went on the lecture circuit, and she started suggesting that maybe we should change the law to allow reasonable accommodation. I mean, if we could bring Lady Hale, if you could have a chat with her, what would you say?
Well, I felt, and you've got to understand, we took it personally in a way, because that's a lot of what this has been about. When I heard this, I felt that we were on the Supreme Court itinerary, on their bookings list, if you like, for about 20 months before we went to court. Why couldn't they have researched this and thought it through before we ever showed up? That massively expensive hearing was heard in the Supreme Court, for goodness sake, and it was only afterwards that they decided to, they might mellow a little to accommodate the likes of us. And we would also put our weight behind this. This should apply to any faith, really. It's not exclusively Christian, it should apply to any faith, because that's the way it was in this country when I started life, that it was a tolerant country. But in the name of tolerance, it seems to be becoming more intolerant.
Now, it hasn't been easy for you. The case was obviously big news. The case that was brought against you was big news. I mean, there's been some vandalism, I think, since the case hit the news.
Each time we're in the news, we obviously let the police know that it's coming up, but they tend to know ahead of us anyway, so they're obviously keeping track of us and what's going on. We've suffered a lot of material damage to the hotel. We have a drive from the main road down to our property that used to be illuminated. It isn't anymore. They've knocked out all the lights. We're situated, I'm going to make you envious now, because at the bottom of our garden is St. Michael's Mount. So we're situated right on the cliff, and we had steps down to the beach, which was a huge asset when we were selling the hotel to people. They've destroyed the staircase onto the beach, and there's absolutely no way we can ever replace that. We've had tires slashed, wheel nuts loosened on the car. We've had other damage. We've had stuff stolen, haven't we, from the property.
Well, Hazelmary, thank you for your courage, for you and Peter. You're an inspiration, you know, to a lot of people. And thank you for telling us your story.